David Smith, good to have you along with us today, and we are getting ever closer to election time. So we thought you might be interested in getting the very latest information on elections from the Secretary of the State, Denise Merrill. It's good to see you, Secretary. How are you?
I'm great. Good.
Well, you've got a busy time coming up. It is now, less than 2 months until election time. I'm sure those who are running, and we should say that the Secretary is not up for election, so that's fine. but those who are running can tell you every split second before that 6 o'clock start time in November.
Yes. Big deal.
Well, it is quite a time this year, and I think there's been more focus on changes, potential changes, trying to make sure that everybody has the right to vote, or maybe doesn't have quite the right to vote. It's a very difficult year this year.
It is. More electoral changes nationally than in 100 years.
And why should that be this year?
Well,
I mean, it's a presidential election, of course.
I think there are forces behind all this. You know, everybody has figured out the mathematics of this, and the mathematics is the country is so divided that 1% makes a difference, particularly in swing states. Now, you haven't seen all these arguments about voter IDs and that sort of thing in Connecticut, number one, because we're not a swing state. But number two, I think we've taken a pretty balanced approach, and so we haven't had the kind of problems that you'll see in other states. But Florida, Colorado, Ohio, Oklahoma, Illinois, Pennsylvania, these states have all seen massive changes in their electoral laws.
And of course, they are the swing states.
They are the
linchpin to the election
this go-around. Yep.
Well, now, what has changed in Connecticut for this election cycle?
For this election cycle, only a few sort of technological improvements, I guess I'd say. In the next few years, we have passed some legislation that we gave ourselves a couple of years to get in place, such things as election day registration. So starting next year, you'll be able to register and vote on the same day. And then we'll have an online registration system to vote starting in 2014. So those changes take time to get in place, so we don't do them this year. This year, it'll be pretty much the same election you've always seen. We've done some nice little tweaks to our website. So for example, if you want to go find your polling place, we have a polling place locator now that we did with Google, and it's very clever. You just put in your address and it'll show you where to vote and give you directions on how to get there.
Well, now that is a very good thing, because depending on the locality that you're in,
right,
it does change from election cycle to election cycle, from local to national and so forth, doesn't it?
Well, yes. I should say this year, actually, there are more changes than ever because we redistricted this year,
right,
which
course.
We do every 10 years. So a lot of towns have changed the polling places. So this polling locator is probably a pretty good tool for those who are a little concerned that maybe they're not in the right place.
Well, you mentioned redistricting, and redistricting has taken its toll on a lot of folks, not so much in Connecticut, although somewhat in Connecticut, but other states rather dramatically so.
Yes. I mean, this year, at least, we didn't lose a congressional seat as we have in the past due to population shifts. There are a lot of shifting within towns, a lot of shifting of borders of state representative and state senate seats and even congressional districts. Our changes weren't as big as they have been in the past, though.
All right, so from a voter's standpoint, what need they know? I guess they should know your site,
right,
certainly, if they have
right.
any question about it.
And they may have changed. Their polling location may indeed have changed, so make sure you check that out.
Okay.
Make sure that you're actually registered to vote where you think you are. Some people think they're registered in a place. They might think that if they have moved, their registration follows them. It doesn't. You have to re-register in Connecticut.
Even in the same town?
Even in the same town.
Okay.
If you've moved across town, sometimes you may need to re-register in the new location if you've changed polling districts. So those are things you really need to check into. I think a lot of people think our system is more advanced than it is, because
mm-hmm.
I think this is one of the last systems where all you have to make all those changes by hand, pretty much at the local town hall.
Okay, so if you have moved, if you have moved within town or from another town, you have to re-register or may well have to re-register.
Correct.
What time frame do you have to do that in so that you are eligible to vote?
In a federal election year, you have to register at least 1 week before the election. So the deadline this year is October 30th. But my advice is don't wait. if you really are still thinking over who you're going to vote for and so forth, that doesn't mean you shouldn't just make sure your registration is correct.
Well, some registrars of voters aren't open on a daily basis.
That's correct.
And so you want to be very careful. Hopefully, towns and cities and so forth are giving extra hours to have people. Can they do that? Can they set their own hours for registration and so forth?
Yes. We have a very local election system. Every town, that's 169 of them, has two registrars of voters, one from each of the major parties. But frequently, these are very small towns. Sometimes the registrars are only open one half day a week. But towns are accommodating, particularly this time of year, and you can always go into the town clerk's office and register to vote that way. So don't think that you need to wait for that day every month or every week to register.
Is it just me, or has there been substantially more primaries this year than in years gone by?
There are more primaries. I kind of think it's because we have made some good changes. Most of the primaries have been local type primaries with state reps, state senate, and even congressional races. We've had more open seats in the last few years. I mean, two open U.S. Senate seats in the same couple of years is very remarkable. I mean, both our senators were there for 25, 30 years. Yeah. So this is a generational change in some ways. So I suppose it's to be expected to some degree.
Talking to Senator Blumenthal, who is currently the junior senator.
As he likes to say.
however, in another 8 weeks, he will all of a sudden become the senior senator.
Rocket to the top.
Almost like that.
That's right.
But that kind of seniority, not necessarily in his case, because his seniority doesn't change all that dramatically, of course, down in Washington, but those 20-odd years of each of the previous senators, very key to the state of Connecticut.
It certainly has been, and it is something that I think we should be concerned about. We're very heavily dependent on defense dollars, for example, so we have a lot at stake in these Senate races, and sometimes I think people think it's just whether you like someone or not. Mm-hmm. Big issues at stake. That lack of seniority probably will not help.
Money is playing a bigger and bigger role in elections, and a lot of people look at it and say, hey, this is the United States of America. This is, everybody is supposed to have a chance and so forth. Well, clearly your chances are greatly increased if you've got millions and millions and millions of your own money or of your party's money or PAC money.
Absolutely, and it is shocking to me this year, the role that money is playing.
It's gonna be the biggest year, unquestionably the biggest year ever.
By far. And that's really because of the new Supreme Court rulings that have really opened the floodgates to a lot of money, and you're seeing it already. And you started seeing it maybe 6-8 months ago. People started lining up with the PAC money. I think the worst thing about it is you don't even know where it's coming from.
Well, that's I think most people's concern. I mean, when we went into election time last go around, everybody was talking transparency, transparency, transparency. Well, when it comes to PAC money, there's anything but transparency. You have no idea who's doing what and why and so forth.
And it could be from out of the country. We don't know.
From out of the country, too.
Sure. I mean, you have no way of knowing, and PACs aren't even a particular kind of entity. They can be a nonprofit. You know, so this has really opened the door to almost any kind of corporation becoming a PAC, so-called, which we used to call a PAC.
Bad enough, I think, that it's domestic PACs, but you're bringing up the point of international PACs, and that's another can of worms.
You don't really know who's giving money to these PACs. I guess that's the way I'd say it.
There's no way
to
know.
It can be anyone. Yes, there's no way to know.
Okay, now what need the national legislature do to alter that, to make it a more transparent scenario that will get by Supreme Court scrutiny?
Well, at this point, you'd have to have an amendment to the U.S. Constitution. It's been defined as a constitutional right, and so now it will be a big thing. Now, there is talk of a constitutional amendment, and there is a growing concern coming from the grassroots and calls on Congress to pass some sort of amendment to reverse this situation. That's a high bar. It's difficult to do, but there's certainly concern out there which may drive that.
Well, as you suggest, high bar indeed. I mean, getting anything accomplished in Washington is a high bar these days, much less something as, quasi-controversial as an amendment of that sort.
Although I would say of all the things down there, this tends to be a little more bipartisan than most things down in Washington okay. these days. I mean, there is concern, I think, on both sides of the aisle about the situation. And no one wants to get into this huge money chase. And by the way, candidates tend to lose control of their own campaigns because a lot of the money going in has to be what they call an independent expenditure, which means they can't communicate with the candidate. So people could be out there saying anything about you and spending any amount of money to do that, either pro or con. And there's really no way you can control that.
But there's also very little way to look into and to counter that, right. unless you, on the other side, have another PAC who is
correct.
Fighting it out.
Funding you.
Anti-ballistic PAC money, if
that's
you
right.
will.
Yes,
along
exactly.
the way.
Yeah. It's a really interesting situation, and I'm surprised that it's playing out this quickly, but I suppose whenever you have competitive situations, it's going to happen.
Well, and the there are not the time strictures on these things either. I mean, a lot of people, a lot of organizations have been packing, if you will, away this money for a long time prior to this election.
Well, that's right, and you have some very, very wealthy people who think nothing of putting $100 million into a PAC. I mean, it's just sort of hard to conceive of that kind of money, but that's what's going on. So it doesn't take very many of those people to sort of swing an election.
Well, and getting something accomplished, as you say, both sides of the aisle are somewhat concerned, but it has to go far beyond that. Then it goes to the
yes.
states. I mean, just from a time standpoint alone, oh, yeah. getting an amendment passed is a long, long process.
Long process.
At best.
Yes.
So do you think that's going to be brought up?
I suspect it will at least be brought up. We'll see what happens after this election, whether the furor dies down. It tends to after elections. But I think this is something that is of great concern to an awful lot of people. So I suspect it'll be around for a while.
All right. Speaking of great concern to a lot of people, the situation in Bridgeport a little while ago was a bad one where we ran out of ballots and it was just a chaotic last, 6 hours of the voting cycle. Are you comfortable that the 169 municipalities in Connecticut are going to take care of things effectively and are set to deal with the realities of election?
Well, I mean, I will say that probably won't happen again because we did pass some legislative changes that give my office some oversight into the ordering of ballots. But you know, it's a funny thing. When things go wrong, the same thing never goes wrong twice. It's always something new. So we'll hope that doesn't happen. We are certainly on the job. I have communicated with every single one of the registrars in all 169 towns. Just spoke at their conference the other day. We've given training sessions to try to make sure that things are standardized across the state. And I've instituted a process where we're using some volunteer attorneys to be available to us if we have questions at the polls. You know, it's still a local process. We have to rely on these people, and they're very good. They really are. I'm pretty proud of our election system. We do a pretty good job. Mm-hmm. So things are going to happen. I hope nothing this time around.
I think we all have had enough for a little while, that's
yes.
for sure. We are pleased to have you here, and we are also pleased to have the president of the League of Women Voters of Connecticut, somebody with
yes.
whom you work hand in glove, I suspect. So we'll do that coming up when we return, okay? Glad to have you along with us. Do have to take a break. We will do that. And, of course, it's Meet the Leaders. I'm David Smith. Stick around. We're going to be back with the president of the Connecticut League in just a moment.